on KBQ 92.9 FM HD2. You can catch us live on KSOH-TV.com as we stream it. You can also catch us, as we say, on Facebook Live. That's under Dr. Kenyatta Cavil, as we say in the show. That's DrKenyattaCavil. For that. But again, Dr. Cavil inside HBCU show with Mike Washington and Charles Bishop. Welcome as we come abroad, and we're here for the SWAC Championship game in Houston, Texas. Guys, I just wanted to get into what are your thoughts in terms of this matchup as we get going. First of all, tell me, Charles Bishop, what is the hot news in HBCU sports this week?
Well, the hot news this week is the Ben L. Cavil Awards. Of course, this weekend is the SWAC Championship game. Alcorn versus Grambling. Rematch from last year, the best in the East versus the best in the West, for a berth to the Celebration Bowl in 2 weeks in Atlanta, Georgia. And what can you say about Alcorn and Grambling? Alcorn, one of the best offenses in the SWAC. Grambling, one of the best defenses in the SWAC. It's going to be a heck of a game.
Certainly, Mike. Give me your HBCU news.
Well, you only give me a few chances to speak during the show, so I appreciate it. And let me first take this opportunity. When I first met Ben, my story is a little bit different, because I've known you for 30 years. He was like, "Yada, who is this little dude?" And talked about me consistently. So I love the big fella, so. But I gravitate to the Cavil side. I've known him 30 years, so you know my loyalties lie with you until Ben comes to the bright side. So, in terms of HBCU news, my cohort here has expressed it. We have the Ben Cavil Awards, but there's a lot of talk out there. And if you look through the numbers and you look through the analysis, they've already put Grambling and North Carolina A&T in the championship. Not so fast, my friend. Okay? Alcorn State has the top-rated offense. They are going against the top-rated defense. Okay? I think Coach Simmons and Coach Haywood also gave great analysis that Grambling State has a great turnover margin. +21 is a turnover margin. So it will be key who can impose their will. And we go into the numbers, we can go deeper and deeper and deeper, but I'll just stop short and say, not so fast, my friend. Let's see who gets past the SWAC Championship, and let's see who ends up in the Air Force Celebration Bowl. So having said that, with no further ado, I'll turn it back because he keeps me on a short leash.
Right. That's what we have to do on the show. He forgets who is the host of the show. The host, Dr. Kenyatta Cavil, and the co-host, Charles and Mike Bach. He fights. A couple of shows ago, he actually took over the show. So he's coming suspicious. thank you. As we get into that, let's go, before we get into analysis of the Ben L. Cavil Award, let's go a little deeper into this matchup. I mean, you didn't let them know into the numbers, and you're the number guy. Like, in terms of how we look at it, what are some things that the fans need to look at that particularly they may not think about?
Well, with Alcorn, they're heavily, if you look at the numbers, and if you look at the course of the whole year, you look at how they're penalized, they're the most heavily penalized team in SWAC. So can they overcome those penalties? Grambling is a very opportunistic team. When we say they're +21 in the turnover margin, that's not only just turnovers. They're turning those points into actually, you know, touchdowns, even in some cases, field goals. So they're very opportunistic. When we started the season, we said, okay, can Grambling's defense do it? We knew their offense could do it, but can their defense step up to that level? You interviewed a couple of folks, and they said they started the season with a chip on their shoulder. And they said, we will end the season as the top-rated defense in the SWAC. They've held to that word. So the question, the biggest question in my mind will be, can Alcorn overcome their penalties? Can they continue to rush because they're the top rushing offense in the league? If you look at how many yards per game, they're number one in the league. So can they do that and avoid the penalties? That'll be key, and avoid the mistakes. And can Grambling continue to impose his will? Grambling's been very opportunistic, but we've seen times in a couple seasons against Prairie View, against Alcorn, where they've fallen short, but due to the mistakes of the other team, they've been able to take care and take opportunities to take over the game at that point. So we'll see.
See, this is why we're in the studio. See, you're in the studio, and I can cut him off. Do the signals. I'll just take the mic and turn off the mic.
I'm not through yet.
Do we have any folks on the Facebook making some comments? Because usually we go in this time and get some highlights. Anybody out there? I'm sure they start to do that. Before we get into maybe some of those names, you got some names for it?
Ben Cavill, Don Morris.
Don Morris is over. He's a Prairie View guy. He's in Dallas. Coaches out there, high school football out there. Give him some shout out. Tell him, appreciate for signing in. Charles, give us a breakdown, too.
Well, I think the health of Northwood, of course. Mm-hmm. Coach Simmons, you know quite well. We're putting more and more dynamic players within the SWAC. The health of him, because Alcorn, I think, is a very different team when he's at the helm of the quarterback. The last turn, one of the top running backs in the SWAC, can he do what he does against the Grambling defense that, as Mike has pointed out, very optimistic. It's going to be key for Alcorn tonight. Turnover the ball, I think, in their first matchup, one in which Grambling won 41-14 in Grambling. Alcorn had 7 turnovers in that game, so Alcorn has protected football. I think we're going to have a very good football game. I think a lot of people will be surprised in terms of Alcorn has a chip on their shoulder. I joked on the show the other day.
We're going to give you the score, then, but not quite on that. Before we do that, let's get into some breaking news. And this is where I'm really feeling strong on what we do. We got breaking news out there that people are not talking about. In terms of what we're hearing is that the current commissioner of the SWAC, George Sharp, has tendered his resignation.
Oh, no.
And so literally, the deal. We got fans that are voicing their opinion about that, and we can do that. So we'll give you a little bit. What are your thoughts on that?
You're getting your mind.
I tried to go tall,
but you got it. Well, I think as I hear some of the reverberations of the crowd, some people say no, but this is not new news to if you've been dialed in. They take into account the decision to end the SWAC championship here. And then some of the talk also go into consideration the changes with the basketball SWAC tournament, the championship back where it's now at a high school stadium. A lot of folks in the SWAC are not happy with this decision. Okay, that's surface stuff. There's a lot of underlying issues that we really can't get into, but a lot of the alumni at various organizations are not happy with Dewar Sharp, and it was kind of a matter of, it's a matter of time. They have basically started a search from what we're hearing through the tea leaves, and they've identified even potential candidates. Now, who they are, we don't know, or we're not at liberty to say. So, if you pay me to buy me a drink, we can drink talk.
It's all a drink. Charles, we give you your mic in regards to your thoughts on this. And certainly, we're not here to punish anybody.
Right.
Dual Sharp has done some incredible work with the SWAC in terms of that. But it's interesting from the SWAC in terms of what is going on in the landscape. Last week, big news was the fact that Hampton University is moving from out of the MEAC into the Big South. So people are really cognizant of the status of the SWAC in regards to the MEAC and life. And the people are always asking these questions about the HBCU, the sporting scene. So these transitions become significant in terms of what does it mean for the landscape of SWAC? What are your thoughts, Sean?
Well, I'm excited going forward. This conference always leads the nation in terms of attendance. When you take a look at some of the classics, Southern Heritage Classic, Bayou Classic, the last week, 66,000 people. You're talking about a conference that has tremendous potential and the opportunity for somebody to come in and really expand on the potential of the conference. Very excited about that. As you mentioned, Bruce Sharp did some great things with SWAC, and it'll be very interesting to see who takes over the reins going forward.
Certainly. Now, for what everybody's here for, let's break down our finalists for the Big Dan Cowboy. But before that, I want to make sure, as I'm holding the mic, that you see my cufflinks with Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated on there. Also has the Ben L. Cowboy Senior HBCU Football Award logo. And so just want to make sure that you see and recognize the stylishness that is taking place. And one of the individuals that has made this worthwhile for me is we have the Vice President of Intercollegiate Athletics, Texas Southern University, Dr. Charles McCullough in the house. Thank you for coming in and for that. So he's done a lot of support putting him on Front Street as he continues to get work done. With that, let's break down some of these players. Start with Mike. Let's start with Charles. I'm going to come back to you, and you keep hollering up this mic. So
okay.
We're going back to you up a little bit.
Thank you.
Let's go with Charles. Break down some of these finals.
Sure. Well, we'll start off with Nico Hollins. Nico, in two games this past season, he passed for 54.3%, throwing over 1,800 yards and 21 touchdowns. He helped Prairie View to the third-ranked scoring offense and the second-ranked total offense in the conference, averaging 30 points per game and over 420 yards per game. Prairie View also led the conference in first downs, averaging 21 per game. Some individual highlights for Nico. Nico threw for game highs of 410 yards against University of Arkansas Pine Bluff, four TDs, including a long that day to Madero Hopkins.
88 yards.
Exactly. He also had a four touchdown game against University of Incarnate Word, and he also had a set of season high in terms of completions just last week against Texas Southern with 26.
You had to find a way to throw Texas Southern in there. Let's give it up. Mike, who you play?
Kadero Hodge, wide receiver, senior. And please forgive me, is it D-Lo or D-Lo?
It's D-Lo.
That's what I thought. People from Mississippi, you know, they were like, so I don't think that the numbers do him justice. Third in the SWAC, 4.5 receptions per game. Third in the SWAC in reception yards at 77, or just north of 77 yards per game. Third in the SWAC and scoring TDs, 6.5 per game. I can go on and on. First in the SWAC and total TDs. This young man just had a total offensive, phenomenal year in this year. But here's what's here's a stickler. In 2016, his career game, 8 receptions, 150 yards against Alabama. I don't know if you remember that. He had 3 TDs against University of Alabama Birmingham. In 2017, he scored a record 18 points, 3 TDs. He went 8 for 232 yards against the same school, University of Alabama. What is it about UAPB? So, again, as Charles alluded to, the long was 88 yards. But please give it up for Kadero Hines.
He had a career game also where he broke a long-standing record, which actually goes back to the family. So I'll let you talk a little bit about that. People don't know the history that you talk about whose record he broke.
All right. So the record you broke was a gentleman by the name of Otis Taylor. I don't know if you remember, some of you wrote. Otis Taylor should be in the Hall of Fame. I was talking to Coach back there about it. My dad was a roommate with Otis Taylor in the 70s. And you broke his record, which stood for 25 plus years. So, again, please give it up.
We talk about Ben Del Cabo Jr. Shaking his head because he knows a little bit about that history as he played for Prairie View and played on that national championship team back in the 60s. So we honor you as well. We'll make sure you do your part of the due. But as we get back to the finalists, back to you, Charles.
Sure thing. Next up is Anthony Stubb. Anthony led Prairie View with 5.5 sacks on the season. He was tied for 9th in SWAC with 7 tackles. He had 7 quarterback hurries, 2 forced fumbles, and he was among the top 20 in the conference with 8.5 tackles for loss. Anthony led a defense that had game highs of 5 sacks against Jacksonville. can you repeat the statement? I'm sorry.
Against who?
Against Jacksonville. The defense also forced 3 turnover games on 3 different occasions against Grambling, Alcorn, and University of Empire Word. Individually, Anthony had individual game highs against McCone College. On October 28th, he had 1.5 sacks. So let's give it up for Anthony Stubb.
As Mike keeps holding on to the mic, in terms of that, I'm going to return it back. We go to our next finalist.
All right, Mr. Sean Jones.
Sean's in the hall, man. He always smiles.
Mike Jones, Sean Jones. So Sean was kind of special because at one point he was listed as a linebacker, and at the other point he was listed as defensive back. So I was like, which one is he? So he played big, his number said so. He was 9th in the SWAC in tackles, 11 games for the Tigers, tied for 9th in the SWAC. He had 6 tackles for at least 3 yard losses. So 1 interception, 4 fumbles. The other thing is he had a total of 70 tackles over the course of a year. 25 were solo, 40 were assisted. Now, Sean, can I ask you to stand up, please? All right, now I'm a big dude. They call me Big Mike. We're about the same size. So for you to take on 25 solo tackles over the course of a year, be 8th, 9th, and I looked at your numbers, you actually were 6th place at one time, and then you fluctuated solo tackles by yourself. That's grown man business. So give it up. So while I bring the purple and gold, I salute you, sir, on a fabulous season. I did get my graduate degree from TSU. So good. Again, gentlemen, I say that in just terrific season.
And I'd like to add the fact that Sean Jones battled through injuries all season long, or you would imagine the statistics would have even been higher. So kudos to you for finding a way to get it done. Keep up the great work. With that, let's go to our next finalist.
Our next finalist is Mark Orozco. Mark Orozco led the SWAC in scoring with 91 points. He led the SWAC in field goals made with 17. Orozco on the season was 17 of 21 on field goals and 40 of 41 on points after touchdown. He was a perfect 8 of 8 from distances from 30 to 39, and he was also 5 of 7 from distances from 40 to 49. Some individual highlights for Mark. His longest field goal this season happened when it needed to happen last week in the Bayou Classic of 42 yards. He also had 6 touchbacks on kickoffs, and on 2 occasions, Orozco hit 3 field goals in the game. First was against Northwestern State on September 9th, and again last week against Southern in the Bayou Classic, he had 3 field goals. Mark Orozco, let's give it up for you.
Mark Orozco is not present because they're still on campus practicing. You may or may not be aware that they actually have the big contest that they're playing for this weekend in the SWAC Championship game as they face up against the Alcorn State Braves. I also like to go back a little bit and talk about Sean Jones, that he was a finalist last year. So he's returning and continuing the stellar work that he puts on the field in that case. But our last finalist, give it to Mike to do the work here.
All right, Mr. Anthony Stubbs. All right, junior linebacker from the Purdue A&M University. Dark. I'm sorry, Devontae. Is Devontae here?
No.
No. So, Devontae is not here, but we can't go on without doing it justice. First of all, the numbers speak for themselves. First in the SWAC, passing average per game, 220 yards per game. First in the SWAC, passing efficiency, 60% completion, 143% efficiency. And if you know how to do that calculation, that is not an easy feat. And then first in the SWAC with the total offense at 250 yards per game. He had one game where he had north of 300, or several games where he had north of 300 yards. If you look at the combination of rushing and passing, Devontae actually was the 2016 winner of the DrKenyatta Cavil. So he was a winner from last year, so that I don't get into any battle, family battles. But I would be remiss if we didn't bring him up. The other thing is that he has been the X factor. And when I say the X factor is he meets that eye test. When Martez Carter went out the game against Southern last week, it was Devontae Kincaid who stepped up. In several instances, this young man has stepped up big where his team needed him the most. So he's not here, unfortunately, but we would be remiss without giving him a round of applause for his team.
One thing that I did appreciate about the Kincaid, like I said, they're back in ground and practicing for the big game. But we have a chance to go to Birmingham where they do the SWAC media day at the beginning of the year in regards to that. And so he made sure that he really appreciated the award. And one of the first things he asked about this year is, well, can I win it again? You find a way to put up statistics and get the wins. I say certainly there's that opportunity. But as we start to close our part and get in where we're going to get into our analysis, last thing I want to give you is Mike, give you an update and give some other pointers that you want to do here in terms of big games and big players.
All right. So I started with Anthony because he came up on my list twice, so I apologize for that. Individual performance, if you look at 2017, it was a season of big performers. We had two players with 400-yard plus performances. Two players in the SWAC, look at all the games. One, Austin Howard with Southern University, that university that's in Baton Rouge. And then we had one who was a freshman who did not start the whole season, who was sitting in our midst, and Mr. Nico Collins, who had 432 yards. So give it up. That's one of the highlights of 2017.
So as we get to the point where we start to announce our awards, one thing I did want to give you as we go back as we did the tease. Mike, who's going to win the game this weekend?
You want to put me on the spot like that?
Okay.
That's
what we do.
Yeah, here we go. As I said in the show earlier this week, because of their balance on both sides of the ball, all season long, you can't go against Grambling. You look at where they are offensively, all statistically. They've been, they've been in the top two or three in total offense, rushing, passing, and most key is defense. They've also been in the top five in what Coach Simmons called that third element, and that's actually special teams. So if you look at Alcorn, they're the top offensive team, especially with rushing. However, they're the most heavily penalized team. So if you look at an opportunistic defense, you look at a high potent offense, I still have to give the advantage to Grambling State University based on that premise.
I think I picked against Grambling all season. That's why I'm going to pick pick against them again today. I think Alcorn has the ability to really run the football, and they're a different team with Lenore's footman if he's healthy. And I really do believe that Alcorn can pull the upset. They have to take care of the football, and I'm calling them. I think Alcorn can do it, and it's going to be 24-20 Alcorn. Is that the end of that?
Dr. Cavil, you're going to pick against the ground with McGee, because you're going to see him in Atlanta in the Celebration Bowl. That gives you an indication of what I think about the matchup. This comes to a close to our part of the show. You can follow me, like me on Facebook, Instagram, at Dr. Kenyatta Cavil. That's DrKenyattaCavil. And as we say at this time,
course
lecture dismissed.